Good evening. Welcome to Bible study tonight. We welcome everyone joining us on this platform. God bless you. And hopefully tonight you can gain some wisdom and spiritual insight by the leading of the Holy Spirit. We also want to welcome those who might be joining us for the first time. We thank you for taking time out to learn at the feet of Jesus. Tonight I'm going to lead us in prayer as we humble ourselves before God. Dear Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for this time of coming apart to learn at your feet. Thank you for upholding us. Thank you for your strength. Thank you for your joy. Thank you for your peace. We give you praise for all things that you have done well. Tonight, we humble ourselves before you to learn at your feet. We lay aside every distraction and we come, Lord, to receive insight, to receive wisdom, to receive grace, oh Lord, for living the way you've called us to live. And so tonight we pray for an impartation into the lives of each and every listener in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. For those who might be feeling heavy or depressed or needing a pickup, Holy Ghost, we ask you to minister to each person tonight.
Yes.
We ask for the spirit of joy and gladness,
yes,
to replace the spirit of heaviness in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
For those, oh Lord, who are looking to you for breakthrough, answer to prayer, healing, whatever it is, Holy Spirit, as the word is coming forth, begin to minister,
yes,
to each individual,
yes,
in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we give you praise.
Thank
we are
you,
so appreciative,
yes,
of your love. We're so appreciative of your goodness. You are a faithful God,
yes,
and
we
bless your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you for joining us again. We're going to go into Bible study, and we're going to learn more in depth about our topic on Sunday, my first love, talking about rekindling our passion for God, coming back to our altars and learning again, you know, that same passion we had at the beginning, like, you know, when you first fell in love with Jesus, rekindling that fire and that passion again, which was the core of what Pastor talked about on Sunday. Can we go to the first slide so that we can begin to go through? I don't want to miss anything. We talked about the worth and excellency of a soul is measured by the object of its love. That's a quote by Henry
Scougal.
Scougal.
Yeah.
And the soul is measured by its flight, some low and others high. The heart is known by its delights, and pleasures never lie. John Piper. And we looked at Matthew chapter 6, verse 21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, the things that you value, the things that are most important to you, that is what you regard as treasure. And that is where your heart will be also. That is where your desires will be. And that's what the Bible is saying, that, you know, what are those things you treasure the most? What are those things you value? Absolutely, those are the things that you devote yourself to. And Pastor was saying on Sunday, he asked us the question, what is it that we love? What is it that we absolutely, you know, desire? And the question is to each and every one of us to dig deeper and see, you know, what is my desire? What are the things that are most, you know, that take up my thoughts? 60% of the time, what takes up your thoughts? Because, you know, the out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What are the things that you talk about? What are the things that you're passionate about? That will give you a little bit of indication of where, you know, where your pleasures are, where your treasures are. Hallelujah. We also looked at Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. Not. If you're just joining us, welcome, welcome. Thank you for joining us tonight. Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. It says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So he goes, he finds treasure in the field. And then he goes and sells everything he has because he wants that treasure. He wants what's in that field. So he buys the field, showing that utmost value has been placed for him anyways. Utmost value has been placed on that field because there's something in there that he absolutely must have. And that's talking about, you know, how passionate we are about the things that we love. And we talked about we are poor physicians of our own souls. You talked about that, how, you know, it's difficult for us to be truthful to ourselves. A lot of times we give ourselves an easy pass, right? I do it myself too sometimes. You know, sometimes like if you're supposed to do 10 laps or on a field and then you did 8 and you're giving yourself, you know, the thumbs up, oh, I didn't do too badly, you know. But if your coach was there and he was standing right there, you do the 10 laps. But if it's just you by yourself, there's a way you rationalize to yourself that, oh, I've done enough, you know, I've been good, I'm doing okay. And so it's hard for us to be physicians of our own souls, but sometimes God has to, you know, show us who we really are, show us where we're really failing or where we're falling short. And that was the episode between Jesus and Peter, where Jesus had to reveal where his heart was. You know, I don't think he realized how deeply affected he was by what had happened. And Jesus wanted him to see what was going on in his heart. And Pastor said on Sunday that Jesus is the only one who can prescribe what we need. He's the master physician. He's the only one who knows what ails us, and he's the one who can prescribe, you know, the panacea for whatever it is that ails us. So Jesus was asking Peter if he loved him more than these.
Let's go and check those scriptures out.
Right.
John chapter 21, verse 15.
It says, when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs.
So he says, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?
Mm-hmm. These, which means what?
It could mean anything. Mm. And Jesus was trying to find out where his pleasures were. Someone said that pleasure is the whistleblower of the heart. Mm. It says pleasure is the measure of your treasure.
Fine.
So basically, if I can find what pleasures you, I know what you treasure.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why that scripture says that the man who found treasure
in the field, right?
The Bible says he went and sold everything. And the Bible says there was so much, he had so much joy.
Mm-hmm.
He had so much joy. So because he found treasure, you can find that in the same text where he's found treasure,
mm-hmm.
there was joy attached to that treasure.
Right.
And so what we're saying here is that just like the Bible says in John, Matthew chapter 6, where it says, where your treasure is,
mm-hmm.
your heart is. And so what we're trying to say is that if I can identify what pleasures you, I can identify what you really, really treasure. And in this scripture, Jesus was trying to diagnose a problem in Peter's heart. He was trying to say, what really is your treasure? What really pleasures you? And he went to the root source of the issue where he said, do you love me more than this? Do you love me more than this? And that's a question all of us have to grapple with at some point in our lives, and many points in our lives, where there are many things that will compete
for our attention. Yeah.
And Jesus is not saying that we should not take care of the needful. He's not saying we should not take care of our families. He's not saying that we should not love our parents and our, you know, we should not put emotion and affection into other things. But he's saying, do you love me more than this?
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus is saying that for us, he wants to be number one.
Mm-hmm.
Numero uno. He's number one above all things. So he comes first. He's not a second thought. He's not a third thought. He's not a passing thought.
Mm-hmm.
And above all things, Jesus comes first. Which means when he comes to time to choose,
mm-hmm.
which is the most important thing, Jesus comes first.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why he was asking Simon, John, do you Simon, son of John, do you love me more than this? And we know that this was as a result of what happened on that fateful night when Jesus was crucified. And it was, do you know that it was a little girl who asked it? It wasn't a soldier. It wasn't
a priest. She asked him in full view of everybody staring at him.
Yeah,
but he didn't want to be one of the things arrested.
One of the things that struck me was the little girl was not even intimidating.
But the situation was intimidating.
It was. We don't know if there were people there who were surrounding the little girl. The Bible says the little girl asked him, were you not one of them?
Right.
And if you look at his response, he was asked three times.
Right.
And he denied the Lord three times. In fact, the third time, the Bible says he was cursed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that situation just exposed. This is the same Simon who was telling the Lord. He said, that conversation where Jesus told him, even before this happened, that before the cock crows, you will deny me three times. Now, if I will, and he said, I will never deny you. I will do all everything, Lord. And he was making all these boastful promises. But a situation arose in his life that exposed him. And Jesus, with the things that will happen in our lives where Jesus will come along and expose us. He will expose us not because he wants to shame us, but he wants to do a correction in our lives. He wants to reset our love. He wants to reset our priorities.
Right, yeah.
He wants to let you know that, look,
not as strong as you think.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Which is why when I said we are poor physicians of ourselves,
mm-hmm.
sometimes we overestimate ourselves,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes we even underestimate.
Right.
Yeah. So it's only Jesus who can give us a true picture of where we really are in terms of our relationship. Right. So that was why Peter's story was very, very important in this topic we're discussing. He says, Lord, he asked him again, Lord, Simon, do you love me? He says, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, take care of my sheep. And then the third time he asked him, Simon, John, son of John, do you love me?
Mm.
But this time around, he really got to Peter. The Bible says Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time. So Jesus was getting to the crux of the matter. He was getting to a place where Simon was already sensitive.
Defensive. Mm-hmm.
And some of us, Jesus is asking us today, and you can play defensive as much as you want. Jesus is the only one who can go into the place where you're hurting, where you're hiding, where there's a lot of shame, and heal you of that shame.
Mm.
He's the only one who has the capacity to do that. And he had to go there because he wanted to do that, not because he wanted to shame Peter. He wanted to restore him.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to restore that love back to him, right? And he wanted to let him, he says, do you love me? He says, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you.
Mm.
And after he said that, Jesus got the response he needed from him.
And you know, another curious thing to decipher from that conversation was, Jesus didn't ask Simon, will you be committed to me? Mm. Or will you be more faithful to me? It came from the point of love.
Yes. Yes.
Because out of our love emanates everything else, right? It's like in my marriage, I love my husband. And from the love I have for my husband, I'm able to give of my time. I'm able to give of my energy. I'm able to give of everything that I have as a human being. I will give to keep my home, strong and my marriage strong, because it emanates from the place of love. And so Jesus wasn't talking about, and you know, when Jesus was addressing the church, what was the name of that church?
In Ephesus. We get there,
right? He wasn't even talking about, he praised them for their commitment, their discipline, all that stuff. But then he said, but you've forgotten your first love. Because a lot of times we do things out of routine, out of a sense of duty, out of fear. But Jesus wants us to do it out of love, where you're saying, God, because I love you so much, I'm willing to give up my time, I'm willing to give up my energy, I'm willing to give up my resources, I'm willing to give up my talent, so that, you know, there's no question, there's no doubt why you're doing it. And to God, it is an acceptable sacrifice. And we talked about on Sunday how Adam and Cain and Abel both brought sacrifice to God. But God could see right through that sacrifice. God could see that one was acceptable and one was not acceptable. And we talked about also last Sunday about how God is going to reward each of us for the things that the work that we've done in the kingdom of God. And we talked about how your works could end up, you know, being burned up. And some will get a reward and some won't get a reward and some will get little reward.
Right.
All based on what were your motives? What is the foundation for your activities in church? What drives you? Why are you in church? Why are you serving? Why are you doing those good deeds? Why are you being, you know, giving to the poor? Why are you, you know, in philanthropy? All those things that potentially could bring a reward, but the reward only comes when God finds that work acceptable, when God finds that service acceptable. And God, Jesus was telling them in that church that this is the only way I will find everything else that you're doing. This is the only way I will find it acceptable, if it comes from a place of love.
Let me just add to that where I said that my pleasure will reveal my treasure, right? And when Jesus was asking Peter, when he was saying, do you love me? He was asking him, do you still find pleasure in me?
Mm. Yeah, you love coming into my presence.
Yes. Mm. Listen to this. Do you know that most of us are married folks, and, you know, some of us are not married, but for those who are married, do you know that you can be married to somebody and after a while you don't find the pleasure in the person anymore?
Absolutely.
And you're just roommates. And it's because over time, maybe things have happened and there have been back and forths and the love has grown cold, but you don't find pleasure in each other's company anymore. You don't want to spend time with each other anymore. The things that both of you used to enjoy doing before, all of a sudden you don't enjoy doing them anymore. And if you take a step back, when you were dating, you could look into his eyes and just kind of, oh, just look and stare, you know, and you could stare at his face for hours just because you're love struck. And if he says, let's go for a walk, or she says, let's go watch a movie, anything she says, you just, yeah, you just want to do it.
Right? Yeah, because, sounds familiar.
Does that sound familiar? Pastor Lolly, let's try to focus here. All right. Right. I'm trying to make a point in church. So she's looking at me like that right now. But the point is, back in the day, maybe when you were cutting, you found so much pleasure, and your pleasure was a reflection of what you treasured, and you wanted to spend time. And in fact, when you get home, you just spend 3-4 hours with this guy on a date, and then when you get home, you get on the phone with him again and speak till midnight. And then when it's time to hang up, you say, you hang up. No, you hang up. Oh, no, you hang up. Listen to me, folks. Why? Because you find pleasure in each other. And Jesus craves that same attention.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave. It was love that drove him to hang on that cross. It was love that held him on that cross. It wasn't because of anything else. The primary reason why Jesus came and went through hell, literally hell, and went through all that suffering and pain for you and me was because he loved us. And love, true love, agape, must be reciprocal. And I said in John chapter 6 or 3, I'm not sure, I think it's 3, the Bible says the bride belongs to the bridegroom.
Mm.
So that was why Jesus was speaking to this church in Ephesus. And we're going to look there quickly, where he said, you have forgotten your first love. Jesus remembered how they loved him in the beginning. And he's saying, wait a minute, even though you're doing all these great things, you're doing the right things, you're cooking for me, I'm just using a physical analogy. You're cooking for me, you're taking care of the house.
Mary and Martha, right?
Right, mm-hmm. Right. You're forgetting me, the person. You're taking care of my needs, yes, but you're forgetting me, the
mm-hmm.
person.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus says we should be careful that we don't get into that error.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why this sermon series is called My First Love. Because we must make sure, like Peter was instructed, that we have to ask ourselves. The Lord is asking us, do you love me more than this? Do you love me enough to give up everything else for me? Am I number one in your life? And if you say yes, there'll be situations that will come in your life that will test that answer, whether it's true or not. And Peter failed that question when he came to it, when it was asked. And that's why Jesus had to restore him back. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. Let's go to that scripture in
Revelation chapter 2,
which is our core text. We want to encourage the people to ask questions today. Praise the Lord. Revelation chapter 2. So we looked at Revelation chapter 2. Now, Revelation chapter 2 begins with Jesus speaking to the seven churches in Asia Minor. And the first church on the list was the church at Ephesus. He said to the angel of the church in Ephesus, right? Remember I said the word angel is the word agalos, which is a Greek word for messenger. It's also the Greek word for the pastor or the bishop. So he wasn't speaking to an angel with the wings, spiritual, the one that we don't see. No, it was actually, the letter was addressed to the pastor of the church in Ephesus, right? And it says, these things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden stars. And I also mentioned, I gave a brief history of Ephesus, being a huge metropolitan city in modern day Turkey anyway.
Yeah.
It was a huge place for commerce. And it held the tech was where the Temple of Diana was located. And I talked about Diana, the goddess of fertility, and how there was a lot of sexual immorality going on in that city. So the gospel was needed in that city, and there was a lot of opposition to the gospel. But this church was thriving in that city. It was doing very well, in spite of all the sexual immorality that was going on in that city itself. I did mention that in verse 2, he says, I know your works, your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. Verse 3 says, and you have persevered and have patience, and you have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. If we stop there, and I said, this is a very impressive dossier for a church.
Right.
This is impressive. Excellent commendation coming from the head of the church, Christ himself. I mean, most churches, I don't think there's any church who won't have this commendation. And I would have thought, well, there's three party, we're doing great. But verse 4 says, nevertheless, I have this against you. Now, if you look at that, it becomes very personal all of a sudden.
Right.
I have this against you. So, if I come to one of you guys listening to me now, I say, guess what? I have something against you.
Your ears will perk up.
I'm like, oh, what?
Okay.
Because that is quite a personal, direct, right? That's a direct, what's the word I can use for it? It's a confrontational statement.
Confrontational.
Right. Yeah. Right. Because if he says, I have this against you, which means, hey, there's something that you're doing that has to be addressed right away. And he says, you have left your first love. That was what he had against him. So are we saying that all these other things he said did not matter? Absolutely not. They were doing all the right things.
Are you saying it doesn't matter?
It matters.
Oh.
It does matter.
Oh.
But do you remember what he says? Do you love me more than this?
Oh.
Do you know that sometimes we might even neglect our first love, but do things for our first love?
Absolutely, yeah.
The things that we do for our first love become more important than the person that we're doing it for.
Yeah.
And that's the key, where it's a balance. We're not saying that we should not be involved in works and do things for the kingdom. We saw, like you said, like 2 weeks ago, we saw that there's a judgment seat of Christ where God will reward us for whatever we do on earth for the kingdom of God and for Christ. But Christ is saying that should not take his own place.
Mm.
It should not come at the expense of us
for relationship.
Right.
It's like a couple where the husband works round the clock. Maybe he's an astronaut or a surgeon. He's gone all the time.
Right.
And you know, the family get comfortable because he's making good money, but he's never around.
Yep, he's never home.
By the time he gets home, the kids are in bed.
Sleeping,
by the time he leaves, the kids are still in bed. You know, so the woman is feeling like she's doing all the heavy lifting. She feels left out. She feels ignored. She feels like no attention.
Right.
You know, and it's a recipe for disaster because unless something is done differently, that marriage won't survive.
Right.
And the kids are going to end up being bitter. And the guy's going to be like, but I was doing all this for you guys. I was working for you. I was, you know, making all that money so that my family can be comfortable. But he neglected something more important. He neglected the love. And I think that's what Jesus was addressing here. That, look, I see you guys are working hard. You know, you're in church. You have programs. You have revivals. You have evangelism. You have choir meets. You have all those things.
Right.
But he's like, okay, but your private altar, the place where you commune with me, the place where you come and you and I can talk, there's nobody there. It's empty. Mm-hmm. And so I think that it was like an alarm bell going off. And Jesus was telling them, no, I'm not happy. I'm not happy. Even though you're doing all these things for me, you like you said, you've forgotten about me.
Mm. And maybe on Sunday, if the Lord permits and the Spirit leads us, we can look a little bit more at we should look more into the altar, where the altar is a place of fellowship. It's a place of relationship. The altar is a place where you spend time praying, studying God's word, and communicating with God. It's a place of a quiet time when you're speaking with Jesus, just you by yourself. There are no distractions. It's just you saying, Lord, what do you have for me today? What do you want me to do today? I'm here to listen to you. You love on him. You worship him. You know, in the book of Genesis, talking about Abraham, Bible says Abraham built an altar, right? But he pitched his tent. Abraham built an altar. We look at that on Sunday, if God permits. But the altar is a place where you put sacrifice up.
Mm.
And it's a form of worship. Anytime there's an altar built, it's a place where you put a sacrifice and you worship God. Right, and that's what we do anytime we come together in prayer, or we worship God in our personal time, we read the scriptures, we talk to Jesus in our personal space. Mm-hmm. That's an altar we have right there. Nobody goes around burning sacrifices anymore. I hope you don't, right? But back in the day, that was the way they could worship God. And the Bible says that he built a permanent structure, which is an altar, right? But the tent was pitched. Notice the two different. The tent is a temporary structure, which means it can be moved,
mm-hmm.
right? The altar is permanent, right? So we must always remember that the altar is more important than the tent itself, right? Bible says he built the altar, but he pitched his tent. So the altar was always there. And I know that every time Abraham moved, even if he moved from somewhere else, he will go to a new location and build a new altar.
Right.
So he spent more time building the altar than more time focusing. He spent more time focusing on the altar itself than pitching his tent, right? And the tent there represents the kind of works we do, the things that we can see on the outside. But the altar is a spiritual language, what we do with God on a one-on-one basis, where we are personal with him.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very important. So let's look at this. I kind of broke down the verses in segments. I kind of explained what each one meant. Let's go back to our context in Revelation chapter 2. Verse 6, he says, therefore, remember where you are falling, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly, remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Now, so I said verse 1, says these things write, sees those, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the golden. I said that represents, that's the picture of Christ representing his absolute authority, his complete control, and his ultimate power over the church. So the seven lampstands in his hands, and to him walk in the midst of the seven golden stands, that's a picture of complete authority and control and absolute power over his church. So Jesus has given us a picture here that he's in charge of the church. He's the head of the church. He's in control of the church. He hasn't lost power over the church. So that's a picture of who he is and the kind of relationship he has with us. He's the one that we serve. He's the one that we love. He's the one that we are answerable to. He's the only one who can judge. He's the head of the church. We are the body of the church. He's the one who makes the decisions, right? So that's the picture of who Jesus is in relationship to the church. Do you want to say something about that?
Well, I mean, it's just, it reminds me of when we were in university days where we used to, workers used to get away for a retreat, like sometimes once a semester or whatever, but everybody just gets on a bus and we go to a remote location and we all get in there and everybody to himself. Mm. And you just go to your own altar. You pray, you worship, you read your Bible, you just commune with God. And then in the evening, we all come together and fellowship. But by the, so it's usually over a weekend, so maybe Friday, Saturday, and we're back on Sunday. Mm-hmm. But by the time you go back to your, you know, mundane lives, you feel so connected. Mm-hmm. You feel so refreshed, mm-hmm. you know, and if I remember anything about, you know, fellowship days or university days, those were the most, you know, precious moments to me. Those were the most, you know, memorable moments for me was when I had time to get away and just spend time alone with God. And that's where you can hear God speak to you. If you're doing something wrong, he can correct you. You know, if you need to improve in certain areas, the Holy Spirit will just come so strong and you can hear him so clearly.
Right.
In those moments. And so there's value to just not, Jesus is not just saying, just come in and just stare at me or gaze at me. Mm-hmm. It's because he wants to put more of himself in us. You know, he wants us to look more like him, be more like him. And the only way we can be that way is when we come away into his presence. And then he can imbibe his own person, his own DNA into us. And so there's value in coming away. There's value in taking time to sit at the feet of Jesus. And that was the difference between Mary and Martha.
Correct.
Because Martha was doing something really good. She was preparing a meal for Christ. She was getting dinner ready. After all, we're not going to starve. We're going to eat, right? And Jesus came over for that same reason, to have dinner with them. But Jesus also came for a deeper purpose. He wanted to spend time with them.
Correct.
He wanted to fellowship. So one day, when he accepted the invitation to come over for dinner, Jesus was thinking to himself, oh, I'm going to spend time with this beautiful women of God. I'm going to be able to talk to them and fellowship with them. But Martha was more into the activities, more into the physical. And Jesus reprimanded her for that. Even then, he said, Martha, Mary has chosen what's most important.
Yep.
She has chosen her first love, to sit at my feet and learn from me.
Yeah, she was just gazing at him, listening to him, and just kind of loving him.
Just soaking up everything.
And meanwhile, Martha was getting angry.
She's getting upset.
She's getting upset, like, right?
She felt like, you know, I need help here, Mary. You're not helping me.
Now, the other thing I was going to explain is, say here is at this junction, is even the disciples had to learn that. If you notice that Jesus, of course, we know that Jesus had 12 disciples. But do you know that out of that 12, there were three that stood out? Mm-hmm. They were very close to him.
Always with him.
They were always with him. I guess the only time they were not with him was when he was taking a shower, or maybe he was taking the bathroom break. I'm just, you know, but I'm just saying that out of the 12 amazing men who followed Jesus for 3 years and turned the world right side up, not upside down, but out of those 12 apostles, there were three of them that were extremely close to Jesus. Mm-hmm. And they were the ones who saw, they saw the things that they were exposed to was because of their closeness,
their
proximity and the effort they made to stick close to him, mm-hmm. right? In fact, we know that when the Bible's in the book of Matthew at the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus said, he called the three of them and says, come up with me. Mm-hmm. And they went up a mountain. Now, there are a group of 12 men. Jesus singled out three, not because he loved them the most, but they were the ones he knew were closest to him,
valued
his presence the most.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was Peter, James, and John. Mm-hmm. And those were the three that he called. He says, come, I got to show you guys something.
Right.
So while the other nine were at the foot of the hill, Jesus led these three up. And the Bible says when they got there, he transfigured before them. And they were the only three that saw Jesus in his glorified form, even while he was on earth. He showed them a glimpse of who he really was. Remember in that encounter, the Bible says he was speaking to Elijah and he was speaking to Moses. And the Bible says he transfigured before them and they saw his glory. They couldn't even look at him, you know, right?
And they wanted to build
an altar. They wanted to build an altar to worship there. But what Jesus was trying to do was, he was telling them that the price, the benefit of you having a close relationship with me is I will show you uncommon things.
I will reveal
to you special things that others will not see.
Mm.
Listen to me. We're not asking you to love on Jesus more than ever and spend time with him because it's the right thing to do. No. There are extreme benefits and perks that come with it.
Mm-hmm.
There's some things that Jesus will say to you that he will not speak to anybody else just because of the proximity, just because of the amount of time, and just because of the kind of relationship you have with him.
Mm-hmm.
He will tell you deep things.
Secret
things, right? We'll talk about the secret things.
Belong
to the Lord. But the things that are revealed, those that belong to us and our children.
Mm-hmm.
So God wants to reveal many things to you and I. But those things are usually he reveals to people who are close to him.
Right.
Remember the story of Abraham when he wanted to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And the Lord said, shall I hide this thing from my friend Abraham?
Mm-hmm.
He actually went to talk to Abraham. Abraham, I'm going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. What do you think?
Mm-hmm.
That is a level of relationship that we must aspire to get to.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. So let's look at the verses in detail. So we looked at verse 1. We said that verse 1 shows absolute authority, complete control, and ultimate power. Verse 2 says, I know your works, your labor, your patience, and you cannot bear those who are evil. You have tested those who say the apostles are not, and have found them liars. So it describes a selfless, hardworking, faithful, disciplined, and discerning church. That's quite straightforward. Verse 3 says, and you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary.
Yeah.
Now, all these qualities are qualities that we can even discuss in another sermon title. Things that we can do as a church, qualities that we can aspire as a church. And I said on Sunday, the church is not the building. It's you and me. We are the ones who make the church, right? So we see in verse 3 that it talks about a persevering, an enduring, a determined, and a disciplined church.
Mm.
But verse 4 is where the key is. And it says, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left
your first love.
Yes. And I think that was where we ended it on Sunday. I talked about the first love there, talking about devotion, loyalty, and passion. Pastor, you want to just talk about that? If there's anything you want to talk about on those three core things that I talked about, that I just mentioned now.
About devotion?
Devotion.
It's like I mentioned earlier, you know, I said that it's about taking time away from your busy schedule and saying, you know what, this weekend, I'm just going to I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to turn off my TV, shut down my cell phone, and just, it's just me and Jesus, you know. It's like Bishop Ejiofor would say, he would bring a chair, and he would bring his own chair and get a chair for Jesus. He would just be in that room, sitting there and just talking to God, you know, just him and God. And so the devotion there is talking about how you can commit to him in giving him your time and saying, God, I just want to spend time with you. Because that's what devotion is. It's about relationship. They're saying, you mean so much to me that I need to take time to let you know how special you are,
yes, or
how meaningful my time with you is. And so, and that's one of God's key love languages. I know God loves
quality time.
Quality time.
Yep, does. He loves, I mean, it.
God loves acts of service. He loves generosity, all those things. But I think the most thing that touches him more than any other is that quality time.
Right, right.
And it's so important for us to find time. David said, early in the morning will I seek you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Mm-hmm. He said, even when I go to bed, you're still with me.
Mm-hmm.
And so David had that he had it, you know, in leaps and bounds, the desire to always be in God's presence.
Right, right.
He said, how precious are your thoughts to me, O God?
Right.
How many, how numerous are they?
Yeah.
You know, so he was always eager, seeking. He said, seven times a day will I pray to you. So he was always hungry for God's presence. And I think that's what devotion really is right. All about.
Right. I think you hit the key word there. It's not just quantity, which is important, mm-hmm. but quality.
Right.
That if you know you're spending time with God, make sure it's a quality time,
mm.
right? Where you give him your devotion, just like you give your spouse that devotion they need. Sometimes my wife will tell you, you know, you've not been spending time with us. I just feel disconnected from you just because I've been busy all week. Sometimes church activities are so overwhelming. And before we know it, we feel as if we're drifting apart. And it's like we have to make a conscious effort and say, you know what, Tuesday next week, I'm not going to go to work. I'm going to call off because I want to spend the whole day with her. And we might just decide to go out and have dinner, or we go out and do some shopping or do some running around and getting things that we need for the house. But in that process, we're spending quality time. And at the end of the day, we'll feel that we reconnect again. And the beautiful thing is, when you spend quality time with somebody, what happens is a conversation ensues. And you begin to talk. You begin to catch up. By the way, did you know that this is what I was thinking? And all of a sudden, that bridge that was there, all of a sudden becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. So quality time is very important. That's devotion. Number two thing about not forgetting your first love is being loyal. Being loyal. That's why he said, Peter, do you love me more than this?
Mm.
Jesus was questioning his loyalty, which is why he hurt him personally, because he thought, but did you say, Lord, you know I love you more than all this?
Mm.
He says, Lord, you know all things.
Mm-hmm.
Because for him, he grieved him because Jesus was actually questioning his loyalty. Right? And that's the key here, where we love Jesus above everything else. We love Jesus above everything else. And so we are committed to him. We are committed to him. We decide that it is Jesus that we love. He's the one that we serve. He says he will not share our love with nothing else. Jesus is, he said, the Bible says he's a jealous God. He is a jealous God.
How do you express that loyalty then?
How do you spend loyalty? Loyalty comes in form of what we prioritize in our lives.
Mm.
Let's make it practical. So there are situations in your life that will occur where your loyalty is tested. For example, nothing extreme. Nobody persecution can arise where somebody will say you have to deny Jesus, and then those things can happen in certain countries, but not most of us will not go through that. But there are things that will test your loyalty. Your job can test your loyalty. There are things that will come into your life where it's not convenient for you to do what God is asking you to do. But because you're loyal to him and because you're committed to him,
he
comes first.
Right.
And whatever price you have to pay, you are ready to pay it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Your manager says you have to come to work on Sunday because we need you on Sunday. And you say, but Sunday, I'm committed, I'm loyal to Jesus, I'm in church on Sunday. I cannot work on Sunday, I have to be in church. And he says, you know what? If you don't come on Sunday, well, we have to let you go. At that point, you have a decision to make. Where is your loyalty? And I know this might sound a bit extreme, but that's the point. Loyalty is extreme. You choose one above the other. I'm married to her and nobody else. It's that extreme. There are no ifs, no buts. You grab onto one and forsake all. And so sometimes life will present you with some hard choices where I just give you that example because that has happened to me many times in my career where I've worked in different places where they say, well, you're going to have to take calls on Sunday or you have to work on Sunday. And I'm saying, absolutely not, because Sunday is a day of the Lord. And whether you threaten me or not, I am committed to Jesus. And Sunday is the day of the Lord. That's the day I'm supposed to be in church, fellowshipping with the saints, because that's what God has commanded me to do. So that's an example of where your loyalties lie.
Mm.
If you say, well, you know what? Jesus understands because he gave me this job anyway, so I don't want to be fired. Jesus understands. Yeah, but no, because that is an example where you have just your job has taken more prominence in your life compared to what the Lord demands of you.
Mm-hmm.
Loyalty will cost you.
Yeah,
it costs you sometimes. Mm. It's demanding. It's demanding. So if you're going to love a woman or love a man, it means no matter who else comes your way, looks at you, blinks at you, makes passes at you, they might be more beautiful than your wife, they might be more good looking than your husband, you're going to say, nope, it doesn't matter how good looking you are or how tempting this is, I am committed to this man. That's loyalty. And that's the same approach we need to have with Jesus. So that's just an example. There are many examples. But life will present us with many opportunities to show whether we are completely loyal to him or not. Mm.
I think another thing I just popped into my spirit was, you know, pain and loss, suffering can also test your loyalty.
Mm.
If, for instance, you suffered a huge loss, like the death of a dear one or a loved one. I went through that when I lost my mom and my sister tragically. But, you know, the first couple of weeks, you're numb, you're in pain, you're completely, you know, out of it. But as the months creep along, sometimes there's a tendency for anger to now creep in.
To God.
And you're like, God, how could you do that to me?
Right.
How could you disappoint me? How could you let that happen? You know, and you can get so angry to the point that, you know, some people are like, I'm done with Christianity, or I'm done with praying. I'm done with, because God doesn't really love me, or he doesn't really protect me. My dad went through that. For years, he wouldn't pray, wouldn't go to church because he was so devastated. And he was like, okay, what is the purpose of my faith if I don't feel any confidence in that faith? Mm-hmm. And so at that moment, your loyalty is tested. Remember, Job said, even though he slay me,
preach for the Lord,
yet will I praise him.
That's the perfect example.
That Job. Is loyalty,
right.
More than anything else,
right,
because
right.
God can strip you of every good thing, take away everything he's given you. Would you at that moment still praise him? Would you at that moment still be able to say, Jesus, I love you?
Correct.
Or you would say, you know, whatever, you curse God, and like his wife said, she said, curse God
and
die, be done with this whole thing.
Just
what is the point, you know? But loyalty can really, really be tested when you're going through a crushing blow, when you're in a hard place, when you've been
the job loss,
disappointed,
right.
You know,
marriage like, broken,
God,
divorces,
where are you?
Mm-hmm.
But let me tell you, he's right there.
Absolutely.
In those moments, he's the one carrying you. And he will carry you through to the point where you can heal and he will restore you.
Amen.
And so don't ever let those things separate you from the love of God.
Amen. Amen. And the third point was passion.
Passion.
Where we said, it's not just enough to be devoted. It's not just enough to be loyal. But you must be passionate.
Mm.
Come on, guys, now. I mean, you have to be passionate. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 22, it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. The Bible says this is the first and the greatest commandment.
Mm.
That was Jesus. This is the first and the greatest commandment. That means that's the numero uno commandment. And there's no other commandment greater than that. Because they asked him, what's the master? What is the greatest commandment? And he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And that speaks of passion. So when there's worship, you're not just cold and just kind of just, oh, well, Lord, I love you. And yeah, whatever. Yeah. But if your hands are lifted up in worship, in adoration, in thanksgiving, and you worship me from the depth of your soul, and you're so passionate, God feels passion. He knows it. He knows it. And that's why, you know, when I was doing the Sycamore Challenge this week, I was talking about Cain and Abel and how God separated their offerings. Bible says, Abel and his offering, God accepted. But Cain and his offering, God rejected. And I said, it's very difficult to separate a man from his offering.
Mm, that's good.
You cannot separate him. Mm. So you say, well, you know what, God, I give you $5. That's your heart.
Mm.
Because your heart is your offering, right? And I don't want to go there today, but so the Bible says, to Abel and his offering. So when God looks at you, he wants to see how passionate are you. If you say, Lord, I love you, how are you saying it? Are you saying just because everybody's saying it? Well, I love you, Lord. You know I love you. High five, God. Or you really, really mean it and you begin to worship and you're on your knees. Whatever way you can worship and prostrate on your knees, you're doing it. And God feels passion. And that's one of the things that we should be conversant about. What's our time? Oh my goodness, time is all gone. Praise the Lord. Well, thank you very much for joining us today on the Bible study. It's been an amazing discussion, and I hope you were blessed. Our time is far spent, so I don't think we'll have time for questions. So join us on Sunday for the next, the part two. I'm not done with this series yet. And we also have our recordings on YouTube and also Facebook. So just in case you missed it, you can always go back and look at it, or invite or send the link to a friend. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So we're going to quickly have a family meeting right now. I'm going to stop the recording and...